and all that he has done. I cannot speak for you, but truly when I think about it, I realize that it is nothing but God's amazing grace. That he looked beyond my faults. And God has blessed me, and he keeps doing it over and over and over again. That's why I just can't help but give God some praise. I can't help but tell God thank you for all that he has done. For I realize that if it had not been for the Lord who was on, I'm talking about on my side. I don't know where you would be today, but I know where I would be today. But it was God's amazing grace that reached down and picked me up out of the miry clay. And I just say thank you, Lord Jesus. Even just this morning when I woke up, I said, when I woke up this morning, I started thinking about the goodness of Jesus. Then when I was able to roll out of bed and walk, I thought about it. He was good yet again. I began to speak. I thought about how good he was yet again. Traveled up and down the Davis highways, I think about how good that he is. Allowed us to make our way out to the house of prayer one more time. And I think about how good he is. And I don't know about you, but I know the Lord deserves all of our prayers. He deserves all of our praise. This morning, we want to, afternoon, call our attention to Luke chapter 24. Begin our reading at verse 13. Reading from the New Living Translation. On this Communion Sunday, as we reflect on the death, burial, and resurrection of our Savior. It's recorded in Luke chapter 24, verse 13. That same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking in the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. As they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them. But God kept them from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing so intently as you walk along?" They stopped short, sadness written across their faces. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, "You must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened there the last few days." "What things?" Jesus asked. "These, the things that happened to Jesus. The man from Nazareth, they said he was a prophet who did powerful miracles, and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. But our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel. This all happened 3 days ago. Then some women from our group of his followers were at his tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. They said his body was missing, and they had seen angels who told them Jesus is alive. Yeah. Some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the women had said. Then Jesus said to them, "You foolish people, you find it so hard to believe all that the prophet wrote in the scriptures. Wasn't it clearly predicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all these things before entering his glory?" Then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets, explaining from the scriptures the things concerning himself. By this time they were nearing Emmaus, and at the end of the journey, Jesus acted as if he was going on. But they begged him, "Stay the night with us since it is getting late." So he went home with them. As they sat down to eat, he took bread and blessed it. Then he broke it and gave it to them. Suddenly, their eyes were open and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared. They said to each other, "Did not our heart burn within us as he talked with us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?" This morning we want to talk afternoon on the subject, when sadness turns to joy. When sadness turns into joy. I read quite a few scriptures, but there was no way for me to cut short the biblical account concerning Jesus and the two on the road to Emmaus. I ask my brothers and sisters to think for a moment that sadness, sad times will come in our lives. There are going to be some moments of sadness, some days of crying. For Deacon Woods led the choir in a song that a few minutes ago, that trouble in my way, that I have to cry sometimes. So much trouble, he said, that I have to lay awake at night. But he gave us the hope and assurance to know that Jesus will fix it after a while. Yes. Brothers and sisters, I want you to know this morning that God specializes.
Oh, yeah.
Somebody say, God specializes.
God.
He may not answer next week, but you just keep on talking to Jesus. But Jesus has a tendency just to show up where you are. But Jesus already knows what we need. Notice that in verse 15, and I ask you to keep your Bibles open, that in verse 15, they were talking and discussing the thing that had happened 3 days ago. When Jesus himself showed up and walked along with them. That lets me know that sometimes we can be too concerned about what has happened that we cannot see the future. Somebody missed that this morning. Sometimes we can get so bogged down in the past that we forget about that Jesus is our hope.
Go! Jesus is the only one who can help us.
Amen.
You know, it may be good, and I think it is good for us to go and see and check on others and do all the things that we can do. But there are times that I don't care what another person may do to try to accomplish that. It's good for them to go and check on that. We ought to do that. When others are down and out and sick and distressed, we ought to go check on them. But it really ain't us that they need. They need Jesus. Notice in the text, Jesus is the only one that can help them. You know, people may do you a lot of good. They may let you know that they care, but Jesus is the only one that can give you joy.
Yeah.
Folk can give you a lot of things, but Jesus can't. Can't nobody outbeat Jesus in giving you joy. Can't nobody. You see, they may give you a dollar or two, but Jesus can give you joy. Jesus can give you something that money can't buy.
Yeah.
I think that real joy. Small